Good evening and welcome to Studio 10 Talks. I am Patrick Cassidy. I'm the artistic director of Studio 10, and it is such a pleasure to be here. I can't believe it. It is January the 17th. This is the new year, 2022. This is our first episode, and do we have an unbelievable guest for our first episode? I'll bring her on in a moment. Gosh, it's been an amazing already sort of 17 days of January. I was in New York. It was an incredible thing. I saw two Stephen Sondheim shows. I can't believe it. I saw Assassins, my alma mater, from 1991. I saw the new revival at the Classic Stage Company. It was incredible. And then I saw Company on Broadway, and that was unbelievable. Made me think about Mr. Sondheim a lot, you know, who was on this show last April. One of his last interviews, it was just incredible. And we're going to talk about that too. But first, I want to bring on our producer. She is a cohort. She is a friend. She's amazing at what she does. Please welcome Miss Julie Garnier. Hi, Jules.
Hi.
Welcome. How are you? Why do you have the Studio 10 background? And I have a Tony Award from my father, not mine, my dad.
I'll tell you why, because behind this Studio 10 background is my clean laundry that hasn't been folded yet. No one needs to see that.
I get that. I understand. How have you been? What's been going on in January for you since you've arrived in 2022?
I'm really, really good. It's been lovely. It's been raining here in Los Angeles today. And so Pepper and I are just holing up at home and just trying to stay warm and cozy and safe, and you know, things are good here.
Yeah, we should tell also the viewers that, yes, you're in Los Angeles. You produced the show in Los Angeles, and I'm in Nashville. So there you go. We can do it. And our guest is in New York. See, that's the wonderful thing about this virtual world that we still live in to varying degrees. So let's get to the show. What do you think? Do you have anything to say? Anything about the show? Pretty exciting.
So excited about this guest. I cannot wait. So yeah, let's get right to it. Lots to cover.
All right. Vanessa Williams is one of the most respected and multifaceted performers in the entertainment industry today. Having sold millions of records worldwide, Vanessa has also achieved numerous number one and top 10 hits on various Billboard album and singles charts, including Save the Best for Last, Colors of the Wind. Also a critically acclaimed actress, Vanessa was seen on Broadway in five shows, and has been recognized for every major industry award as a television actress and recording artist, including a Tony nomination, 4 Emmy nominations, 11 Grammy nominations, and much, much more. She is also a New York Times best-selling author and an activist. She is a strong advocate for equal rights, especially concerning the gay community and minorities. Please welcome the incredible Vanessa Williams.
Hello, Patrick.
Hi, Vanessa. Look at you. Okay, so you have the beautiful fireplace going. Where are you exactly?
I'm at my house in Westchester County, New York. Yes. And we're just getting into the 30s after, I think it was 2.5 days of 6-degree weather. So awesome. I'm thawing out right now.
So we're happy about the 30s, right?
Yes. 30s is like, woo, heat wave.
Well, as I said to you, when we met a few minutes ago, I said, I've been such a gigantic fan of yours. And I saw you once and in Beverly Hills, and I wanted to go up to you, and I was truly too bashful. I am a big fan, and you're amazing. What a career! And so much that you do, so much.
I have a lot of interests, and I'm happy to be able to do what I like, which is fantastic. I get bored very easily, so I love the options that I have and that are in front of me. So,
well, let's just start with Broadway.
Okay.
The show, you know, Studio 10 Talks has been so fortunate to have had so many unbelievable Broadway people on it, including, like I said, Mr. Sondheim, one of his last interviews. So you made your Broadway debut in Kiss of the Spider Woman, is that right?
Yes, that was my Broadway debut, although I did my off-Broadway debut in a show called One Man Band that James Lacine wrote and starred in. And I was one of the there were three kind of featured background singers. So that was my first New York Times review, because I got a good review in the first show that I did in New York. That was back when Theater Row on 42nd Street.
Sure, was, very well.
Yeah.
Did you grow up in New York?
Yeah. I live in my hometown, actually. So I moved back here in 1993. So my kids all grew up. They went to the same schools that I did. So yeah, my mom lives next door.
That's great. Now, and you replaced Cheetah Rivera, right? I loved that show, by the way. It was fantastic. Oh, there you are. Look at you. Wow.
Yeah. That was the tango. So I was called, I was called in by Garth Drabinsky, because the story that was told to me was that they were doing Showboat, and that there was a possibility that the Julie that they had was not coming to Broadway. So this would be an opportunity for me to not have to go out of town, but just be Julie on Broadway and Showboat. I was like, absolutely. So I went in and sang, "Fish gotta swim and birds gotta fly. I gotta love one man." So can't help love that man. And they said, "Thank you very much, but we want to talk to you about something else." And they said, "Would you think about replacing Cheetah in Kiss the Spider Woman?" At the time, I was living in LA. I hadn't seen the show yet. Huge fan of Cheetah's. Oh. And I went to see the show. And instead of butterflies, I was like, "I can do this. I can do this." And it was one of those things where, at that point, Save the Best for Last was a big hit, and I was known as, I'd gone from being a scandalized beauty queen to a recording artist, popular recording artist with a number one hit. And so I was coming in from the recording world, as opposed to people not knowing my musical theater background. Mm-hmm. So I knew it was going to be a great opportunity to not only sing and dance and act, but also be in a...
Were you trained as a dancer too?
Yeah. I studied modern dance the whole, growing up. And then I went to Syracuse University for my, for musical theater, along with my first show that I did there was a musical review featuring Jimmy Van Heusen's music. And Aaron Sorkin was in my first music, because Aaron was a musical theater major at Syracuse. Aaron was 2 years ahead of me. Yeah.
How did he become such a genius writer and now director?
Well, he grew up he grew up in Scarsdale. His dad was an attorney. And I think he's just a brilliant guy. And he was, a great actor and a performer, but he knew where, his real true talent was. Yeah.
Well, I want to show a little clip from, then after Kiss the Spider Woman was Into the Woods next?
No. After Kiss, I did St. Louis Woman for Encores when Jack O'Brien directed that.
Sure.
And we were trying to get this to go on a commercial run. And what we heard was it was just too big of a show to put on Broadway, because we had like a 40-piece orchestra. I mean, it was a beautiful production. And then after that, I did Kiss the Spider Woman. But Kiss, 98 was a St. Louis Woman. And then I did
Into the Woods. Into the Woods.
Yes.
Okay. Well, we have a clip of you as the witch, right? Into the Woods, right?
Yes. Play the witch.
Take a look at this. Tony.
And they all got what they wished for. But at what cost?
Hear all the things you say, children will listen. Care for the things you do, children will see and learn. Children may not obey, but children will listen. Children will look to you for which way to turn, to learn what to be. Careful before you say, listen to me. Children will listen.
Yeah. Was that the first time you ever performed on the Tony Awards?
Yes, that was the first time I performed on Tony's, yes.
Were you nervous?
No, because, you know, I've been doing it
doing the show.
Yeah, we did it out of town in LA, which was wonderful. And at that time I was married, and so we had a house in LA, so I got a chance to live at home, and my baby was, she was only 1 year old, and I could bring her to, you know, backstage hanging out. And my other three were, you know, back and forth. So, no, it was wonderful.
Yeah. Well, I got to do the Tonys one time, and it was the same thing. I've been doing the show for a long time, but I was still like nervous. It's like, I mean, the only thing that got the nerves out of my thing is because the number that I got to perform was a big dancing number. So, you know, you get the junk out, right? Yeah. Did you have, was that production, I think my father's best friend growing up, was it John McMartin?
John, amazing. And his wife, Charlotte, but John was a lovely, lovely man.
Yep.
So kind, so effortless, such a joy to work with. Yes. Yes, that was, we did that. Well, it was interesting. Again, similar to what's happening in theater now. This was right after 9/11. So nobody wanted to come into the city. Nobody was traveling. There was no, the tourism was really down. So I think we could have had a longer run had it been in a normal, you know, at normal times. But we had, you know, we just, so 9/11 happened in 2001. We were just casting and in rehearsals. And we went out to LA in January of 2002. Did our run at the Amundsen, and then came to New York in May for opening. But again, people were not, you know, people were scared. Yeah. It was a major, major thing. So it was a strange time in life for that show again. And also, you know, that time in the theater.
Let's talk about Mr. Sondheim. So yes. you did Into the Woods, and then you got to do Sondheim on Sondheim, right?
I did.
How'd you like working with him?
Well, I, you know, when you're a musical theater major and you're studying Stephen Sondheim in class, and you're doing performance class, and the first song that I sang was "There Won't Be Trumpets or Bolts of Fire to Say He's Coming." Yeah, "There Won't Be Trumpets," which is beautiful, and I his melodies are so gorgeous, and all you have to do, not all you have to do, but just to be still and commit and let the art work for itself. Mm-hmm. You don't have to work hard for any of Sondheim, which you know. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So when I heard that, and I had seen the Into the Woods, the original road production in LA, because another person who went to Syracuse with me, Tracy, was playing Little Red. So we would see Tracy in Little Red, and Cleo Lane was playing the witch back then. So when I got the call to that they were thinking of redoing it, but also making some changes, I was really intrigued. And I sang "There Won't Be Trumpets" for Steve and James. And then one of my favorite stories is when we were rehearsing at 890 Broadway, they wanted to have the last midnight have some different lyrics. So back then when there was a fax, faxes machines were there, and the fax would come in, and James is standing next to me, and he's looking at the new lyrics for "The Witch." He's like, "Oh, the witch takes her bloody hands and smothers a baby. Steve, she's not going to kill the baby, okay?"
Oh, gosh.
No. Like, "I'll just eat the baby. If you want me to, I'll eat the baby."
Oh, gosh.
So, but he was lovely. His notes were very succinct, and if you got any, which I was like, just give you one. Mm-hmm. And most of the time it had to do with pronunciation.
Totally.
Yeah. And when I did Sondheim on Sondheim, I was in the middle of doing Ugly Betty. Actually, it was the last season. And James called and said, "Listen, I'm doing this project about Steve. I'd love for you to join." And we worked it out, thank God, with the producers of Ugly Betty. And so I could do simultaneously.
Look at you. There you are in the round. That's on Sondheim and Sondheim. Wow, look at that.
Look and at there's you. Norm.
Yeah, I see it.
But underneath, that was that number. And I knew that it was going to be really special. Oh, Barbara Cook.
Yeah, the best.
What an amazing, beautiful creature she was.
The best.
Yeah. So I think the highlight of that production was getting a chance to go to his townhouse.
Oh, yes. I've been there for a couple times, too. Yeah. Yes. And all the games he has everywhere. You know, he collects games, old games.
Games, yeah. And it's jam-packed with just wonder. And then he was like, I guess it was Spencer Tracy, I think, and Katharine Hepburn used to live.
Katharine Hepburn.
Yes.
I know Katharine Hepburn, dude, because she used to wake her up because he played piano. He wrote like at 2 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
And it drove her insane.
You're right.
It drove her insane, you know?
Yeah. So that was, you know, going to his house, having his number in my phone was always, tickled to me. And it was just, and I would see him after we did Sondheim and Sondheim, and I would see him out and about, and he was always surrounded by boys, always had a big grin on his face. And I would say, "Hello, Steve." And I said, "It's Vanessa Williams." I said, "Hello, Vanessa Williams." But you know, he was wonderful and talented and just serene.
Yeah. And as you said, he gave such, when he gave notes, he gave such a specific and wonderfulness. He said to me when I did Assassins, he said to me, "Patrick, you know, you sing on the diphthong." And I said, "What's a diphthong?" he said, and he explained it to me. And then I say, and he says, "And that's why you got this. Other parts you wouldn't get, but for this particular character, it's better." And then I learned not to sing on the diphthong when I had to. But anyway.
Right, Yeah, same thing. He told me about the new instead of new, new.
Yeah, yes. Yes. Yeah.
Diphthongs was his thing. We got the same note.
You also, I recently, that did you star in the revival of City of Angels in the West End?
Yes, which got, we were in our first week of previews, just about to open, and then COVID, you know, killed us.
Holy smokes. Yeah. I love that show. It's not done a lot because of
the white
and the color thing. It's hard.
Josie Rourke, who's our director, did a brilliant job making it work. And it was a really extraordinary production. It was the one that she had done at the Dunmar Warehouse about 6 years ago. So the same producers, same design team. And it was such a tragedy that we couldn't put it back up. But everybody's, I mean, it's expensive production. Everybody's working. And then in between that, I also did After Midnight, which was a joy, you know, singing classic Duke Ellington tunes, having Wynton Marsalis's orchestra behind you every night. You know, it was just one of those, as soon as you heard the first downbeat, you were just ready to roll. And it was, you know, I sang Stormy Weather and Sunny Side of the Street and just beautiful, gorgeous songs. Got a chance to dance again in that. And it was, and Warren Carlisle was a choreographer for that and director for that too. So it's been fun.
Okay, so now we're going to segue into your television. By the way, this show could go on till next Thursday if you're into it. You have a fire, you know, we'll get some water. You know, it's you've had this huge television career. You created some amazing characters. Tell us about Ugly Betty.
Ugly Betty came about, it was 16 years ago.
Wilhelmina Slater, is that it? Wilhelmina Slater.
And I had been offered my father actually passed away today on MLK Day 16 years ago. I had gotten a call from my agents because it was pilot back in the day. It was pilot season, February, March. And they said they want to see you for the show. And I was like, I don't want to act. I don't want to do anything right now. I need some time. So I went with my family to Egypt. So they go, "Well, can we get you on the phone?" I go, if you can call me on the Nile, then okay, I'll answer it." Of course, didn't work out at that time. So they went and cast the everybody else. And then I get this call probably a couple weeks later and saying, "We need you to do this show. You need to show up for your costume fitting tomorrow." And apparently whoever they had cast as Wilhelmina did not work out when they did the read. And I started and jumped right in, and it was truly, and you'll understand, it was like a company, an ensemble that all were trained. You could throw anything at them. They'd give it to you right back. And it was that kind of company, that kind of ensemble that you knew that you're always supported And that's why it works so well.
Yeah. That's the best. And it earned you 3 Emmy nominations?
Yes, it did. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
That's
but the writing was amazing. The costumes were phenomenal. And again, I got a chance to play with amazing actors.
That's the deal. If you're lucky enough and to get to, as we said, throw the ball back and forth, somebody you trust, somebody who's really good, it just makes you better. And that's the fun. And if you can do it too, like, you know, in a long run of a show, if you have that too, in a long run of a show, that's what makes it fun. That's what keeps it, you know, new and inspiring every night. And
well, I talk about Michael Urie, who's brilliant, Juilliard trained, and we were shooting the pilot, and the gag was that Wilhelmina was going to fire an assistant every episode. You know, she couldn't stand it, and she'd fire him. So Michael is supposed to be giving me Botox in this particular scene. So I'm lying down on a white couch, and I'm saying, you know, talking about, am I old, darling? What do you think? And he's like, oh, of course you're not. And he's giving me Botox, and he's like, there's a little bit left. So he said, and he's like, can I have? I said, go ahead. So his idea was not only to come back in the next scene with one eyebrow up because he didn't have enough to finish himself off. And then the next scene we did together, I walk into this big conference room. There's a big round table. And he completely copied my walk immediately. And then I slunk into my seat and he slunk in at the same time right next to me. And I said, this guy is brilliant. He can't go because he was only paid as a guest player. And he ended up being a permanent cast member.
That's great. Yes. Yeah. And so talented. And then you got to do a Desperate Housewives. That was nice. Mark Cherry.
Well, Desperate Housewives came because Mark is a huge Sondheim fan. Came to see the show. And then I got a call the next week saying, would you like to join our cast? And then he gave me all the funniest lines in the show when I joined for 2 seasons. He knew, you know, he had the timing, and, you know, he was a great writer, and I got
he's
a chance.
You know, he's a great singer himself too. That's why he's in musical theater. He was with as a young performer, he was with the Young Americans.
Yes. Was that a musical theater? Oh, okay.
Yeah. It was like a singing troupe, you know, and he traveled the country, and yeah, no, he's terrific. I've known Mark a long time. Okay. So now tell us about RuPaul. Tell us about this. I love this.
My latest gig.
Your latest gig.
Well, I mean, I've known Ru for years, and my latest RuPaul gig, he's an executive producer, but it's called Queen of the Universe. It's on Paramount Plus. And it was a competition for drag queens, but singing live. So no lip syncing at all. We shot it in London, September, October. It was fantastic. And the talent was remarkable. Worldwide, from, of course, the United States, Brazil, England, you know, China, India. It was spectacular. The production value was fantastic. And then at the very end, the audience chooses who won. So if you haven't seen it.
Yeah. And isn't it also like for some of them, some of the contestants said forbidden, right? In their, where they live to, and maybe dangerous to perform in drags in some of these places. No,
I think, yeah. I mean, you know, we're so used to,
I know
we're the lucky ones. Yeah.
I mean, how does that go over in India?
Well, at this point, Ronnie, I think, who was our Indian queen, I think she's a worldwide known queen. So she's going to have to deal with whatever happens. Cause you know, this is a global competition seen by so many.
What a great experience for all of you. That's, oh man, I'd love that. Okay, now we get to talk about your recording career.
Well, it was actually the 30th anniversary of Save the Best for Last this past couple weeks. And one of our composers just passed away on Saturday. John Lynn.
I saw that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
So
he wrote the song. Yes.
So the three of them. So John Lind, Phil Galston, and Wendy Waldman worked together as a team. And so John was one of the three. They also wrote The Sweetest Days as well. And so it just seems like, maybe because we're all home, but a lot of people are exiting the earth at this
point. You know, and also, that's so funny. You are the third person that has said to me, literally in the last 48 hours, that exact statement.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's frightening.
Yeah. Yeah.
I want to show a video, though, of you. Okay. In terms of your singing, that kind of encapsulates you so much of your singing career. Take a look at this.
Okay. Let's go.
What an incredible ride with that song. Remember the first time you heard the song?
I do. Ed Eckstein, who was the head of the label, the Wing label that was on that signed me, he played it for me, and he was sitting at his desk, and at that time, I think was it a cassette or was it a DVD? I think it might have been a cassette. Because we're talking, probably like 90 or so, 89, 90 when I first heard it. But it's funny, I was looking at that clip and I remember like, okay, pregnant with Jillian and dreaming, okay, pregnant with Devin, what I did work to do. It just, a trip down memory lane. But I tell this story about Save the Best for Last. It was offered to Streisand. Her people passed on it. It was offered to Bette Midler. Her people passed on it. And so you just never know where it's going to come. And it was meant for me.
It was, I think this marks the 30th year anniversary of the song.
Mm-hmm.
Is that right?
Yeah, wow. Absolutely.
Well, that's true of so many. I hear that about, actors that were passed. I mean, Tom Selleck, Burt Reynolds passed on. What was the movie that, Terms of Endearment? They both passed on it. Jack Nicholson gets it, wins the Academy Award.
Exactly.
Eric Stoltz shot the first 2 weeks of Back to the Future, and they went and saw The Rushes, and they said, this isn't working. Michael J. Fox becomes a movie star.
Well, I passed on Monsters Ball, and Halle won an Academy Award. But you know what? It was not the role.
I know. I talked about that with students when I teach. I talk about the ones that I didn't get, both in theater and television and film. And you start to look at those and go, wow. Mm-hmm. Well, Sean Penn, congratulations. So talk to me. Okay. We're going to play a little game on this show. Okay. Yeah. It's called Remember the Lyric. Right?
No.
What it is, and we're going to bring Julie back on because she's going to give me a note. This is a song from a show or a film or something that you sang.
Right? Okay.
And I will sing a lyric, and then I'll point to you, and you come back with me the next lyric, and we'll see how far we can go. Okay?
Okay.
Here we go. Julie, come back on. Give me that F.
Hi. Hold on 1 second. I'm going
to
do this.
Now I'm nervous.
You're gonna do great. All right, so your opening note is an F natural.
Here we go. Come run the hidden pine trails of the forest.
Come taste the sun sweet berries of the earth. Come
roll in all the riches all around you.
And for once, never wonder what they were.
The rainstorm and the river are my brother.
The heron and the otter are my friends.
And we are all connected to each other.
in a circle, in a hoop that never ends.
Yeah! Ding, 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 ding.
Oh, I didn't know we were doing it in the same key.
You understand why I play this game? Because now I got to sing Colors of the Wind.
There you go. Okay.
I've sung If I Loved You with Kelly O'Hara. I've sung Don't Cry for Me, Argentina with Patti LuPone.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. So I have now. I now can rest easy for the rest of my life. I got to sing that song. Thank you. Right. Thanks, Jules. I appreciate it. So tell me about Colors of the Wind. You know, you know that it won, I guess, an Oscar, Grammy, and Golden Globe for best song. Wow,
it did. And the songwriters get those wonderful trophies, which was amazing. Alan Menken,
And Stephen Schwartz.
Stephen Schwartz, yeah, exactly. Yeah. I sang it live at the Academy Awards in 1996. So that was nerve-wracking, because that was like, okay, we're live. I'm singing live. I've got aerialists and dancers and a revolving staircase in a Versace gown and heels. Don't mess up.
How much? You know, I've never gotten to do something. How much rehearsal do you get for something like that?
I think we maybe had two days or so.
Really?
Yeah. I think so. Yeah, it was that was at the Dorothy Chandler Pavilion back when, you know, that's where they had the Academy Awards. Yeah. So it was a little more intimate and felt more, felt more at home. Mm-hmm. You know, when you walk into a space and it feels like natural. So yeah. That it wasn't overwhelming. It wasn't like a stadium or anything.
Have you ever sung at Carnegie Hall?
I have. I did a concert there. Let's see. Jeez, it was for like a Valentine's concert, and the money went for, it was a benefit. There's so many disasters. I'm trying to remember which one it was for. But it was for some disaster relief, and I can't remember. It had to be at least 15 to 20 years ago.
Yeah, I it's a great place to sing, though. I got to sing there once, too. What a great set. And, you know, Norm, our friend Norm Lewis, who's a very close friend, he was supposed to sing. It was all booked and all that, and the pandemic hit. And he was, but I think I've spoken to him. They've rebooked him because he goes, he hadn't done it yet. So he was done it. Yeah.
He must.
Okay, I want to talk about activism and how many things that you're involved with. Your charitable endeavors are many and varied, embracing and supporting such organizations as Black Theater United, the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, Special Olympics, Broadway Cares, Equity Fights AIDS, and several others. You were honored with the Human Rights Campaign Ally for Equality Award for your humanitarian contributions. That's amazing.
It was wonderful. One of those things that was very organic. My parents were both music educators growing up. My parents had tons of friends of all different backgrounds and ethnicities. And I grew up having representation of wonderful, smart, talented, creative gay men my whole life, where my father completely accepted everything. So there was never any judgment in my household. So this was something that, and of course, being a dancer and having all my friends, most of my male friends were gay males as well, and being in theater as well. Mm-hmm. So it was a very comfortable and organic subject that I could talk about, because I reflected on all those amazing influences that I had growing up and how there was no judgment, and how I wish that my experience growing up could be that for so many others, which it's not.
Right. No, you're 100% right. You and I grew up in similar households, you know, although I had a couple movie star parents, but other than that, and some rock star brothers, but other than that.
That attitude, but it's important. It not judging, not shaming. Right. There's, you know, look where we are today, mm-hmm. and you know, I know that it's obviously we're in the middle of Martin Luther King weekend, but you know, you kind of look back and say, have we made progress? I mean, are we right back to where we were born in the 60s and mm-hmm. the same things that our parents had to strive and hope to make a better world for us? Did that actually last? And then when I was Miss America in 1983, thinking the world had changed and the 20 years of my parents had, you know, brought me up and the world is different. And then having death threats and hate and all this stuff at 20 years old in 83, it seems like it's cyclical. Every time we have the same, we're confronted with the same problems, but I guess perseverance is what it's all about.
And continue consistency. And, yeah. You know, one of the things being an artistic director, we're getting ready to do our Aretha Franklin legacy, which is kind of like Smokey Joe's Cafe, but we're honoring Aretha Franklin.
Well, nice.
And yeah, it's an incredible show. And, you know, Aretha Franklin, yes, the queen of soul, but what she did in terms of activism, what she did and the barriers she broke in terms of her career is what we're going to try to highlight as much as we can with some great performers. But it has to be consistent. Mm-hmm. It has to be consistent. You know, my prayer is that what's happened in the last 2 years, that hopefully something actually lands and there's some solid, you know, there's something solid about it in terms of people. And as it, like I said, for Studio 10, that's what we're pushing for the next.
Yeah.
As long as I'm here.
And voting, that's another big thing on our agenda. But we talked about activism, and as we mentioned Norm Lewis, but we started, we helped start founding with some amazing, of course, Audra McDonald, LaShawn's, and
this is the Black Theater United.
Right? Yep. And it came out of we needed a response because we were horrified by what we saw through, you know, George Floyd's death, and mm-hmm. we needed to say, what can we do? And we didn't know how we were going to approach it. We didn't know what our first, you know, agenda, you know, item was going to be. But we knew we had to do something. And we've luckily been able to make changes, not only in the theater community, both commercially and regionally, but also for voting and for the census and for reform and inclusion. You know, there's a lot of work to be done, but you got to.
And that's exactly right. There's a lot of work to be done. Audra was on the show. And we talked about that too. It's not just about the actors, and it's about playwrights. It's about people in the crew, stage managers. And you know what I mean? It starts there. Yes. And of course, playwrights, I mean, and producers.
And theater owners.
Yes. Okay. Yes. Okay. But, I want to show a little video actually about Black Theater United. Julie, can you throw that up there? Is that Lilias White?
That's Lilias.
Love Lilias White.
Yes.
Oh God, is she brilliant.
So I produced that video, which I had to do in COVID. I had to get all the protocols paid for and the testing before we could even walk, and also get the venue. So that song was written by Phil Galston, who wrote Save the Best for Last, mm-hmm. and Dave Schroeder from NYU. I was a visiting professor for that whole year. And he said, I know what you're doing with BTU. I think I have a song that's going to be perfect for you. I played it for everyone. They loved it. So now that's our kind of our theme song.
Oh, it's absolutely gorgeous. Oh, and you guys all sound fantastic.
We did them all. Some people did them on their phones. Some luckily had a recording, opportunity. And then Karen Ford, who was our in our foundation, but she's also a sound designer. She mixed everyone's to make it sound great. So it was a combined effort by everyone.
Well, just so you know, while it was playing, I got a text from one of our board members, Danny Anderson, saying, well, you've met your match. She's far more beautiful than you are, Patrick. But I totally agree. 1,000,000%. You are ageless. You know, do you know the movie, The Picture of Dorian Gray? You know, there's a female version, and it's Annette Williams.
Uh-huh. Well, thank you.
ageless. So I want to talk about your books. You've written two books?
Yes, two books.
Okay, so your autobiography, You Have No Idea, and it was a co-write with your mom, right?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. There it is.
Yeah, it was one of, I had been asked to do an autobiography, and I just felt that I hadn't achieved anything when I first was asked by Judith Regan back in the day, and I just felt that it was going to be an easy money grab. And I just said, I need to have a career so I can look back and show not only the struggle, but where I ended up, it's accomplishment. So every time I would get these offers, I'd go call my mom and say, what was I doing then? And what was happening there? And she would be like, well, I remember this. And I said, well, I remember that. And we ended up coming up with the idea of, like, while I was going through this, you are going through that. And it's kind of a point counterpoint.
Oh, great. Where,
like, for instance, when I was on the road as Miss America in my 20s, I had no idea that my parents had an FBI box with all the threats that were coming in from all over the nation. And my mother, my parents would say, just, you know, when you go to Chicago, just be careful or watch out for, you know.
But as a parent, having to feel that and hear that,
And not tell me, because they didn't want me to. Yeah.
That's horrible.
Yeah. Oh, so.
Wow. Yeah. And it was a New York bestseller.
Yes. And it goes through our whole lives and our tough times together as mother and daughter, but the love that we share and how important family is. So it was a hard one to do, but I'm glad we did it together.
I collaborating with your mom. I got to perform with my mother for 20 years. Ugh. It was the greatest experience in the world. It's the one thing I have on my two brothers, where I said, and it was amazing. So lived with her in New York, first mother and son to star on a Broadway show. And then of course all over. Yeah. It's an amazing thing to do that with your mom. And then in 2020, you released Bubble Kisses. First picture book for children, which tells the story of a young girl with the ability to transform into a mermaid. The book is based on a song that you sing, and the book comes with it, right? I mean, we have a clip of this book.
Okay.
Take a look.
I got a goldfish and her name is Sal. She's not just a pet. She's my pal. We play a lot of games together, though they're all pretend. And the other kids wonder why she's such a special friend. Now she can't roar like a lion, bark like a dog, scratch like a cat, or jump like a frog, run like a deer, or do a hummingbird hover. But here's the reason that I really love her. She gives me bubble kisses, as she swims by in the water. She never misses with the bubble kisses, and I'm so glad I got her.
The Bubble Kisses was honored with the American Book Fest Award, the National Indie Excellence Award, and the International Book Award in the category of Best Children's Picture Book Hardcover Fiction. That's fantastic. Good for you.
And I was just so tired of Baby Shark. I was like, I've got to do something else.
is there anything that you don't do?
I don't do taxes. I can't stand.
I can't wrap my head around addition and subtraction.
Yeah, and I'm also at this point now where I go onto a set and I've been through so many. You know, I've done action adventures with Arnold Schwarzenegger. I've done sitcoms and all that stuff. And now it's just, I think I'm in producer mode, because I'm like, okay, we can get this in a two-shot. Can't we just, you know, I'm always trying to figure out how to move the camera. So possibly directing might be in the future.
Yeah.
But now it's just like problem solving. It's like, oh, we're wasting our time. What's going on? we should be, you know, so that's producer.
You know, 10 years ago, a little, maybe a little bit, maybe 12 years ago, I started making the transition from performer. First of all, I wanted to teach. I was a coach in football with my kids and basketball and all the sports. And I really loved working with kids and stuff. And I thought one day I kind of walked into the bedroom and I said to my wife, I said, I want to teach. I knew more about musical theater and performing and camera than most people in acting classes. So I thought, and I started with a little group of kids, and then that grew to colleges, and I started going to colleges, and then I started directing at colleges and teaching sort of as a guest semester teacher. And then that went on to Vegas and back and forth. And what it is that you start to realize that over the course of your whole career, you've really learned so much than other people know, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what you're saying. And you go, yeah, I know how to do this. And then when I became an artistic director, I never designed a set. I never designed lighting. I'd never designed costumes, but I sure know a lot about it. Mm-hmm. I can sure weigh in on it. I can even weigh in on budgets, which, like I said, I don't add or subtract, but I can weigh in on it.
Yes.
You know? But it's amazing what happens. I mean, I'm in my 41st year of being a performer.
Wow.
Or being in this business.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. Amazing.
Okay. So the Hollywood Walk of Fame, 2007, you got your star. How was that?
It was great. It was the first season of Ugly Betty. The show had just become a big hit. We won our Golden Globe that year. And it was one of those, like, riding the wave, you know, got my star. And it was in recording, because that's where I'd had, I think, my biggest impact, that really shifted everything and opened a lot of doors that were closed because people judged me. You know, getting in the beginning, it was like, you're a beauty queen. Okay, you must not be talented or have any kind of intellect. And then finally breaking through to the recording, which was tough as well. Then it's like, okay, you're a recording artist. Can you really act? Can you really do it? So it's always, my career has always been like, oh, I didn't know she could do that. Oh, I didn't know she could do that. And that kind of is the fuel to my fire. Like, okay, just wait. Just you wait.
But I want to ask something. Aren't beauty queens, just to get in those contests, don't you have to be really smart?
Well, you know, I never worked the system. So, I mean, my whole, in a nutshell, you know, Syracuse freshman year is your core year. You can't do anything. Mm-hmm. Sophomore year, you can start auditioning. And I got into the Aaron Sorkin Swinging on a Star with Jimmy Van Heusen, which I sang, love is lovelier the second time around, just as we put both feet on the ground. So that was my big number there. And then I got into, I did Golden Apple. And then I was auditioned for Cyrano de Bergerac. They were doing it at Syracuse Stage, which is a repertory company. So I got the Orange Girl, which is a tiny part, but it was going to give me some equity points. And the show got canceled. And I had April free. And one of my classmates said, you know, I got a friend who's on the board of this Miss Greater Syracuse pageant. Do you want to do it? And I was like, no. And I called my mom and it's like, this pageant they want me to do for Syracuse. And she's like, is there scholarship money to be earned? I go, yeah. So I won Syracuse in April. I sang Being Good Isn't Good Enough from Hallelujah Baby. My friend played the piano. That was another classmate of mine. Then I went to New York State in July, sang Being Good Isn't Good Enough yet again. And then I was headed to Miss America that September. So within 6 months period of time, you know, I went from a musical theater sophomore to an international, you know, change maker.
Yeah.
So it was extraordinary and terrifying and heartbreaking. And it's part of my legacy.
All in one. Yeah. Your journey. I have a feeling that this job and this achievement may be your favorite. Melanie, Jillian, Devin, and Sasha.
Yes.
Those are your four children.
My four children. Yes. Yes. Those are my biggest accomplishments. So yes. And you know, luckily I did it throughout my career. You know, I didn't stop my dream. I made my work coordinate with my kids. You know, there was a lot of things that I said no to that were out of town that didn't work because I had to be there for my kids. So those sacrifices, I don't miss at all. I don't have a second thought about any of that stuff.
You're fantastic. Gosh, it's such a pleasure to talk to you. It's such a pleasure to meet you. I want to talk about your upcoming appearances, even in the global pandemic. You're one of the busiest people in the business. So you have some concert dates in Palm Springs on Saturday, the 22nd of January, 2022 at the McCallum Theater, right? There it is.
Yes, down this Saturday, yes.
Wow. And the 50th anniversary of the Kennedy Center. You're going to be a special guest performer.
Yes.
Can you tell us what you're going to say?
I am doing first act. I am going to do Hit Me With a Hot Note for Sophisticated Ladies, of course, Ellington. And I'm going to do an amazing West Coast swing number in that, which will be wonderful. I'm working with my dancer on Wednesday. And then second act, I'm doing the beautiful kind of mashup that I did with Barbara Cook in Sondheim and Sondheim, where I sing I Think About You, and Sierra is going to be singing Not a Day Goes By. So yeah.
Oh my gosh. And then sometimes Anyone Can Whistle at Carnegie Hall on Thursday, the 10th of March. Okay. You know, that show isn't done. I've never seen a production of that show. I love the music from that show, but it's not done very often.
I know, you know, Ted Sperling, who was my musical director when I did Kiss. And also when we did, speaking of yet again, Norm, when we did Showboat with the New York Phil, Ted was our musical director for that. And he called and said, do you want to do it at Carnegie Hall? I said, of course. I mean, love working with Ted. But again, at that time, you know, Sondheim was still alive, but it's just, his music is alive and it's I'm riding the wave. And it, again, it's just an honor to be a part of something that, you know, gets a chance to be seen again.
His music will outlive hundreds of generations, thousands of generations, you know?
Absolutely.
So we play one final game on this show.
Okay.
It's really easy. It's called You Become the Host, which means you get to ask me one question, only one. I will say that Patti LuPone said to me, how many women have you bedded? So please don't go down that road. I told her only one of any significance, and that was my wife. So, but you get to ask any question you'd like.
Where, in what situation were you the most nervous to meet a celebrity?
It was that day at the Four Seasons Hotel when I was looking at you from
besides me. There's got to be another story.
You know what it was? It's a great question, Vanessa. The reason I do this is because I get to think about things that I like the brain had fried and it comes right back. I was doing the series of Dirty Dancing and I was playing the Patrick Swayze part. This was in 1987, 88. It was for CBS, and you know, you go to New York for the upfronts and the affiliates and blah, 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 blah. And we're all there, and all the stars and the new shows are there, right? And I saw the team from 60 Minutes, Mike Wallace and Ed Bradley, and I was in shock. And I literally walked up to each one of them, Diane Sawyer. I was like, oh my God, forget that lead on this television, like Friends, who cares? I was like, I want to meet Mike Wallace, Ed Bradley, and Diane Sawyer. And I walked up to them, I could barely say my name. And I said, I just want you to know, I literally thought of them as like gods. I mean, they were so, I mean, their brains and what they talked about. And that's a great question.
You're heavyweights. You've got the taste.
And what about for you? Well, I have to ask that question of you. How about for you?
Probably Lena Horne. I burst into tears. I mean, icon. And I've been able to work with, I mean, Lena Horne and Eartha Kitt and Cicely Tyson. Right. I mean, it's just been Diane Carroll. I've had such a wonderful life. But Lena, for me, was the goddess of goddesses, you know.
Yeah. She said something, she had a quote, because I saw her one woman show in New York too. She had a quote that what separates her from any other performer, they said, how are you, she says, is nobody thinks like me, only I think like me.
Mm.
That's what made her her. Mm-hmm. Now I know it's true. She's Lena Horne. She thinks like Lena Horne, and nobody thinks like that. And that's what makes her Lena Horne.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I was lucky enough to go to her funeral, and some of the old servicemen got up and basically told the story about when she came to sing for the troops. They had all the black troops in the back of the audience, and they put her in the front of the stage, and she got down. They would not move the black soldiers in the front, and she got down and started her performance from behind in the back to sing to her people. And they said, she will always be our pinup girl. And the pride and the ownership that they had because she did that for them, you know, again, she's just the be all that ends all for me.
Well, you are amazing. I can't thank you enough for doing the show. You're just so terrific. Go to www.vanessawilliams.com and go to all these dates. Go to the McCallum Theater. Go to the Kennedy. Listen, watch the Kennedy Center. Of course, anyone can whistle at Carnegie Hall. You are an absolute gem. Thank you, Vanessa. Such a pleasure. I'm going to call you, and I'm going to call Brian, your rep, and I'm going to say, won't you work for me?
Okay.
Thank you.
You got it.
So much.
Thanks so much.
Pleasure. Great.
Take care.
Well, that is our show. What an incredible show. I can't believe it. Oh, gosh. That's like she asked the question. I've always wanted to meet her. And then get to interview and talk to her. I hope you guys enjoyed it. I want to talk about a few things. We have a couple of minutes about Studio 10, what we have coming up. So we just announced, we just put on sale our Aretha Franklin Legacy, which I talked about earlier. There it is. It opens February 10th. Legacy for Studio 10, if you guys don't know, is one of our biggest shows. It was the show that we had to shut down when the pandemic came. I brought in Robert Clater to direct it. He has directed Dreamgirls all over the world. We have an incredible musical director here by the name of Ronnie Robertson is going to do our M-Day. We're going to have a huge band. We have six of the most incredible performers. It is going to be the music of Aretha Franklin like you've never heard, and what she meant to the world, to the music industry, but more importantly to the world. And then during Valentine's Day and after the 14th and the 15th of February, we have Love Letters with Sally Struthers and John Chuck on the 14th and the 15th. And then on the 21st and the 22nd, we have Miss Kathy Lee Gifford and Mr. Patrick Cassidy. We are doing Love Letters. Get your tickets for both Aretha Franklin Legacy and for Love Letters with Sally Struthers and John Chuck. And then with Kathy Lee Gifford and Patrick Cassidy, that's the 21st and the 22nd of February and the 14th and the 15th of February. Get your tickets. Come back. We're going back into the theater full force. Come support Studio 10. You can donate too. Always donate, please, at studio10.com. We need donations. We can't stop working for them. There it is at the bottom of your thing. You can press the button or by messaging STT or at 202-858-1233. Please, please support Studio 10 in all ways. We are coming back. We are so thrilled. And we have more shows even after that in April and May that I'm going to talk about. Thank you, Julie Garnier, for being such an incredible producer. I love you, love you. Thank you, Vanessa Williams, for being a spectacular guest. Guys, be healthy, stay healthy, and be safe. Good night.